Hey guys, welcome back to the channel, and today I'll be going through what you need to know when it comes to consenting your patients, and I'll also be covering some of the trickier situations like Gillick Competence and the Mental Capacity Act for vulnerable adults. So my name is Ali and I'm a final year dental student studying at Newcastle, and today's video, as I've already mentioned, will be covering obtaining valid consent, which is the third GDC principle. We'll be covering a quick history on English tort law cases to do with negligence, and then we'll talk a bit about what valid consent actually is, followed by consenting children under 16, and then we'll finish off by talking about consenting vulnerable adults who don't have the capacity to consent for themselves. There are timestamps on the screen now and in the description, so if you have anything that you're specifically after, feel free to skip around. Let's get started. I'm not going to bore you guys for too long with the history of it all, but just a bit of a background to do with case law, to do with negligence. In 1957, Mr. Bolam, a man undergoing electroconvulsive therapy at a mental health institution, wasn't informed of what the treatment involved and wasn't given muscle relaxants while being treated, and so he suffered serious injuries. He ended up suing the hospital management committee, and because of it, the Bolam test became part of the law and basically states that if a medical professional reaches the standards of a responsible body of medical opinion, then that medical professional's actions would not be negligent. In 2015, the case law of Montgomery versus Lancashire Health Board disregarded and replaced the Bolam test with a greater test in negligence by stating that the doctor is under a duty to take reasonable care to ensure that the patient is aware of any material risks involved in any recommended treatment and any reasonable alternatives. Material risks here includes what a reasonable person in the patient's position would be likely to attach significance to that risk, or the doctor is or should reasonably be aware that a particular patient would be likely to attach significance to it. Okay, so for consent to be valid, it needs to be 1, voluntary, 2, informed, and 3, obtained by the correct authorizer who must have capacity. Without this valid consent, without these three things, you'll be assaulting the patient, and that's only more reason that you should be learning exactly what consent is and what it includes. Voluntary means that a dentist can't influence the patient to make a decision by pressuring them into doing what they want. Informed consent, as defined by the GDC, is achieved if a patient has received enough information to make a decision, and we'll go through what that means. There are 6 things which should be discussed with the patient. The first is what the treatment procedure involves and the reason for doing it. Then we need to inform them of the benefits and the material risks of the treatment. You'd need to tell them what would happen if you don't do the treatment, how much it would cost, and the alternative options with their associated benefits, risks, costs, and whether you think that treatment is appropriate. Finally, you should ask them to see if they have any questions about what you've just discussed. Capacity refers to if the patient can communicate back to you what you have just explained to them, which displays proper understanding. The information needs to be retained and evaluated so that the benefits and the risks can be weighed up, so that a decision can be made. It's important to note that consent is an ongoing process between the dentist and the patient, and they have the right to withdraw consent at any point, including during the procedure. There are 3 ways that consent can be given, and the first type is non-verbal or implied. And an example of this is if the patient is sitting in the chair, then it is implied that they accept for you to carry out an initial examination. The second type of consent is verbal, and this is needed for treatments like fillings and scales. And the last type is written consent, which is needed for treatments which have bigger risks associated with the treatment, like undergoing a general anesthetic or needing a surgical extraction, for example. Now we'll move on to talking about who can consent for children under 16. There are 9 groups that we'll mention here, and the first is the child's mother. The second is a child's father if he was on the birth certificate, but it used to be a little bit different if the child was born before December 1st, 2003, and you can pause on the screen now if you're interested on how that used to work in terms of consent, but I won't go too much into detail because it's no longer relevant. The third is civil partners, and they need to have been civil partners at the time of conception, which is either donor insemination or fertility treatment. Next is consent for non-civil partners, and this is achieved by the second parent applying for a parental responsibility agreement after becoming a civil partnership, or alternatively, they would both have to register at birth. The 5th and 6th group that we'll be talking about are step-parents and legal guardians who need a parental responsibility agreement from the biological parents or a court order. The 7th is if the local authority has consent, which would be joint with the parents if there's a court order. But if the child's under the care of the local authority voluntarily, then it would still be the parents that are responsible. The next is to do with Gillick competence, which states that a child who is younger than 16 can consent for themselves without the presence or knowledge of their parents if they are both competent and have capacity, so they fully understand the treatment in such a way that they can communicate it back to you and weigh up the benefits and the risks and retain that information. It's important to note that while a child can give consent for treatment to happen, if they refuse treatment and the parent consents for the treatment, the child's decision would be overruled. It's also important to note that a child might be able to consent for certain treatment, but not for others, because while they might be able to communicate, understand, retain, and evaluate for Fisher sealants, they might not be able to communicate, understand, retain, and evaluate the options for a maxillofacial surgical procedure, for example. The last group that we'll be talking about are younger children who are 16 or 17 years old. This group can consent for themselves and can't be overruled by their parents, but in certain circumstances, a court order might be used and the child's decision may be overruled. Finally, I'll be speaking about vulnerable adults, and the way you test this is with two questions. One, does the patient have an impairment or a disturbance affecting the functioning of their mind? And two, does that impairment or disturbance mean that the person is unable to make a specific decision at the time it needs to be made? You also need to constantly reassess capacity each time a decision needs to be made. And this is especially for patients who have a fluctuating capacity. If you think that a patient may regain capacity, then if possible, you should delay the decision-making process. There are five main principles mentioned in the Mental Capacity Act of 2005, which have to be considered. And these are: one, to assume capacity unless established otherwise. 2, to take all practicable steps to help the person make a decision. 3, to respect the capacitated person's decision, even if it's unwise. 4, the decision made on behalf of a person who lacks capacity has to be made in their best interest. And finally, 5, the decision made for the person must be the least restrictive option. When an adult needs to make a decision but doesn't have the capacity, you need to find out if they have made any advanced decisions to refuse treatment, if they have a lasting power of attorney, an LPA, or if the court of protection is involved in any way. If none of the above applies to a particular person, then you need to act in the best interest of the patient. An advanced decision, sometimes known as a living will, allows someone who was both over 18 and had the capacity at the time of making the decision to refuse certain treatments in the future. A lasting power of attorney is a legal document which is given to a close family member or a friend on behalf of the patient who might be expecting to lose capacity in the future. There are two types of LPAs, and one type is the personal welfare and the other type is the financial, so you need to make sure the one you're looking out for is the personal welfare LPA. Again, the patient needs to have been over 18 and have had the capacity at the time of appointing someone to be their attorney, and they must be registered with the Office of Public Guardian. So if you've checked and it turns out that the patient doesn't have an ADRT or an LPA, then you need to act in the best interest of the patient. You need to try and involve the patient and their family as much as possible and consider the patient's past wishes. And if there are any significant risks associated with carrying out the treatment, then you'll need to request an IMCA, an independent mental capacity advocate. These advocates help to make sure the treatment is worth doing by weighing up the benefits and the risks for the patient and making sure that the rights are upheld. Usually these IMCAs are quite good at getting an in-depth understanding and could speak to loads of different medical professionals, from the GDP to the GP to specialists, and even sometimes involve the anaesthetist. On the screen is when an IMCA must be consulted versus when an IMCA may be consulted, so you can have a little read of that if you want. Okay guys, so that's pretty much it on obtaining valid consent, and I hope you found this video useful. If you did, we'd really appreciate if you guys gave us a like and subscribed. You might also enjoy some of the other videos on our channel, so feel free to check out some of the suggestions here. Also, if you guys notice anything that I might have missed, then just throw it in the comment section below and we can all benefit from that. And we'll see you in the next video.